appreciate his work, but I also want to recognize John Tate, who represents us at the national level. And John, I believe, is standing up here. But it's great to be with friends. I give speeches in Washington, but nobody shows up. So I have to go to Orlando. John came to me a couple of weeks ago, or months ago, or whenever, when he pesters me with my schedule. Are you going to go here? Are you going to go here? And he says, we want you to come back to Florida. And I said, back to Florida? I've been there. And he said, yes, but that's where the most enthusiasm is and the best organization. We need you to go back to Orlando. So that's why I'm here. Revolution in this country. Then this past week, Nancy Pelosi called up and said, come on back, you've got to spend some more money. You know, we were out of session, so to speak, for the month of August. We were supposed to go home, and Democrats were supposed to try to save some seats. But they called us back. She called us back and said, we're going to have an emergency session that lasted about 4 or 5 hours. But she said the world would come to an end if the American taxpayers didn't spend another $26 billion and do it immediately. So, amazingly, it passed. The Democrats had more votes than Republicans, but I don't know what would have happened if the Republicans had been in charge. They might have been wanting to pass it themselves. Who knows? But it passed. But the question is, where did they get the money? We don't have the money, and we've stolen so much from the American people. They're flat out broke, and they don't even have jobs, so we can't steal any more from the American people. And the world's not loaning as much money as before, so in order to keep the interest rates low and finance all this welfare, warfare spending, guess what? We just send the bill over to the Fed. Don't sweat it. Don't even ask any questions. Just send a bill to the Fed, and you know what they do there. They just crank it out. They don't even need a printing press anymore. All they do is just click the computers and create $26 billion just like that. Then they wonder why the economy is weak. You know, they say that monetary policy is complex and very hard to understand. But you know, it really isn't. If you've ever played the game of Monopoly, you know that Monopoly money is not hard to understand. And you know, if you take two Monopoly games and put the money from both sets in, all you do is push up prices, right? And you know, I have found over the many years of talking about monetary policy in particular, whether I talk to grade school, high school, adults, college kids, or whatever, it seems like they really understand about monetary policy. It's not all that complex, but it's very, very important. And of course, that has been one of the subjects that I have been dealing with for so long and motivated me in my early years to run for Congress because the Austrian economists, the free market economists, had predicted 1960s. As a matter of fact, even earlier than that, Henry Hazlitt predicted when Bretton Woods was established, it wouldn't work. And he was right, the rest were right, and it did happen in the early part of 1971 on August 15th, Bretton Woods broke down. So that really confirmed that Austrian economic theory was absolutely right, and the Keynesians were absolutely wrong, and then I was motivated then to start speaking out on that issue. And but I'm not too many people interested. But I did talk about the Fed a lot, got to Congress, talked about the Fed a lot, and still not many people paid any attention. And I brought that subject up, you know, a couple years ago in a campaign. It was a national campaign. And to my surprise and to my pleasure, there were a lot of you who cared and understood and knew exactly what was wrong with the Federal Reserve. And I am so glad that we now have that as a very important issue to deal with in this country. When I talk to the young people at college campuses, they volunteer this as a very important subject. I'm also very pleased when I talk to young people on college campuses that the issue that attracts their attention the most is the issue of war and peace. You know, we do the polling. The polling came out today and said what the American people care about is, you know, right now they care most about jobs, and I can understand that, and they should, because they have to worry about taking care of their families and paying their bills and and they aren't very much worried about it. You know, and, very often in the past you've heard people saying, well, that people vote from their heart, and you shouldn't vote from your heart, you should vote from your head. I've always argued that people vote from their bellies. And if they have an empty belly and they're concerned, economic policies do carry a lot of weight. Well, the job we have as members of the Campaign for Liberty is to take the concept of liberty, make it very important, make it a moral issue, and turn it around and say that if you do care about your bellies, that's the only way you can feed people, is have freedom and property rights and sound money. That's how you take care of people, if you care about them having jobs and having a high standard of living. This is why the concept of liberty is so important, because then what comes out of it, our economic system that comes out of it, is therefore the economic system that to me is the only humanitarian system around. The campaign a couple years ago was a big surprise to me. I was invited to run by many of you, and I called, and I was reluctant. Believed that very little would come of it, little would. I always figured that the few things I've done over the years, little good always comes of it. But I was very reluctant. I was finally talked into doing it. I went and did it, but to my surprise, the reception for our views and sound money was so overwhelming. But to me, the most exciting thing has been that when the campaign ended, I thought, well, I'll just go back to being that unknown congressman from Texas. And I will go and do what I thought my job was trying to set an example, and, you know, and do this very bizarre thing and looking at every single bill through the eyes of the Constitution and vote against them. Speak very well, and I don't get it, but it's a powerful message. It's a powerful message, and we do know that this message does generate a lot of interest and a lot of activity. But the young people are looking at this, and they're saying that there is something rotten with the system, something wrong, and we're inheriting this mess, and we have to do something about it, and they know where the answers are. The answers are found in the American tradition, the things that we believe in and we've understood. The tradition of independent thinking, personal liberty, and of course, in order to achieve our peace and prosperity, we have to change our foreign policy. I see a lot of young people come to Washington and come through the office. In the old days, that would happen on occasion. The parents would come in and they'd have some teenagers or others straggling along, and then so would insist the kids meet their congressman, that sort of thing. Today it's different. The young people come in dragging their parents in. More than the parents, but they'd sit their parents' house and say, you have to look at this stuff, you know, and bring it in. But a lot of them got interested in the campaign. But what surprised me, which pleases me still, is that they will come into the office, and I meet them around the country, and they'll say, I said, when did you get interested in what was the subject? That's usually what I ask people. And now they'll say, well, a year and a half ago I saw this, or 2 years ago I saw this, which means that there's a lot of people still, you know, coming in our direction as part of the momentum. And that's because people like you are out there spreading this message, and the Campaign for Liberty is out there. And of course, the real clincher has been that so much that we have expressed concern about, like the economy, all of a sudden, you know, has collapsed, and nobody's believing that stuff they pass anymore. Nobody trusts Keynesian economics. Nobody claims they want to be a socialist. And so that when you offer them something else, all of a sudden they say, you know what, this is different, and this is what we have to do to hear and move along with something that so far hasn't been tried. But this, to me, is the wonderful thing about the momentum and the way things have continued. This, of course, has created a lot of anger in the country, and a lot of it is very positive. Now they're at the point where they can say, you know, there's something wrong, the economy is collapsing, the wars are lasting forever, we go to war without the declaration, and it goes on and on. And now they're wondering about what we're going to do about this, and of course, that is what the answer is going to be. It's going to come, from the Campaign for Liberty. So the challenge we have is, how much influence are we going to have with the people in this country today who are unhappy with their government? And believe me, more than the majority of the American people are unhappy with the government. They think it's simply, well, the Democrats did this, put it in the Republicans. Republicans do this, put it in the Democrats. We know there's something more to it than that. There's a lot of anger, a lot of sincere concern, a lot of people suffering, and they want something new and different. Our job in the Campaign for Liberty is to promote the cause of liberty in order to compensate for all the bad ideas that have been floating around this country for so long. This is not an easy undertaking. I'm convinced we're further along than I had anticipated we would have been if you'd have asked me 3, 4, or 5 years ago. Things are moving rapidly. We are making great progress. But the big question is, they're recognizing what's wrong, and there's a lot of anger and concern, but what are we going to replace it with? Who will put the ideas out there? What do the people stand for? We have these spontaneous meetings. We had a few of those during the campaign, Tea Party, meetup groups, and all of this, and it was spontaneous, and I thought then it was generally pretty well agreed upon what we all stood for. Today, it's very healthy in the sense that there are more than ever, but because it has grown so rapidly, it's miscellaneous. Sometimes we all these groups don't agree on everything. And I don't think it's necessary that happens. The one thing we don't want is to have somebody who say, these are the 10 points, everybody's going to agree on these 10 points, and then you can join the crowd and fight the people in Washington. But I do believe that some broad viewpoints have to be understood. I don't think that just being unhappy with the government is enough. I think it has to be understood that we are taking on something that has been around for a long, long time. It's ingrained in our system, unfortunately. We have lost our way over 100 years ago. We lost interest in our Constitution, lost confidence in ourselves, changed our foreign policy, and that has to be reversed. So we're not talking about a change in election. We're talking about the philosophy of a country, because the government we have is a reflection of the philosophy of the people. So if the people believe in socialism and welfareism and warfareism, that's what you're going to have. But if the people decide that's not what they want, the government will not be able to do it. The people will resist, and they will have to just accept the fact that the attitude is changing. We're in the midst of that right now, this attitudinal change. But what we're doing is we're challenging a status quo. And the status quo, those people who maintain the status quo, are very, very powerful. They happen to have most of the wealth right now and the political power. They have access to most of the professorships in the universities. They have control of most of the media, but they don't have control of the internet. Yeah. Of many of our liberties and the continued encroachment of our liberties, we still have a lot of freedom left in this country because we were able to come to this room tonight. We may have some monitors, we don't know. And we came here tonight, and we're still allowed to meet, and I'm still allowed to speak my will here. So I would say that as long as we have that, and as long as we can participate, then we can change people's minds. The biggest job in the world that we have is changing people's minds. And that is where we're making the greatest progress. Out of necessity, more than anything else, but this is what's happening.